A comment at this point.
Well, Bob, I should now introduce Professor John Cohen, who has just introduced himself, actually. Professor Cohen is Professor of Psychology at Manchester University.
When these boys, or mostly girls, pounce upon Mick and seem to want to tear him to pieces, it's not essentially an act of aggression, but rather an act of devouring him. They want to incorporate his essence. It's a sort of fetishism which has more in common with people collecting the relics of saints. You know, when James Dean's car was, after he died, was put up as an emblem of his sanctity and his mystique, his fans and devotees would pay any amount of money for screws and bolts at $20, $50 a time as amulets. These are incorporations of the mystical, magical quality of the idol, the hero that they worship. And that's why they would like to tear him to pieces and eat bits of him and have bits of his clothes, locks of his hair, his autograph. I'm sure you must get thousands of people who want your picture. Your image, you see, is the double of you, is your soul, and with your autograph on it, that's something of you. And they want to incorporate this in themselves.
This sounds as though you regard this whole phenomenon as religious.
Yes, well, I do. I would say that this particular phenomenon is not to be looked at in isolation. You must look at the whole spectrum or gamut of situations, ranging from, say, a humble Punch and Judy show at one end to the solemn celebration of a high mass in a great cathedral at the other, and in between football matches, tennis at Wimbledon, wrestling matches, bouts, football fights, the Beatles, even courts of law. You have this range of situations which are sacred events taking place in a circumscribed place, a circumscribed time. They must begin at a certain time, the curtain rises and the curtain falls, and the magic is attached to that place, to those events in that time. Now, you have those things happening there, and the people watching, looking, the onlookers, the viewers, and these participate in those magical events. And you can have many, many kinds of participation. Now, you've mentioned some. The more passive the onlooker, if you were just sitting in a cinema seat looking at the celluloid goddesses, the more intense is your psychical, your mental or spiritual participation. But if you participate physically, as in your pop sessions, then this has an effect upon your mental and emotional participation. Most of the magic is in the projection, not in the identification.
It'd be interesting to hear if Mick Jagger wonders why he wants to get up in front of people. And most people, I suppose, are happy enough to stay private. Yet performers seem to need to get up in front of audiences. Is it something you've thought about?
Yes, I've been only thought about it because I've been asked about it. I never asked myself the question why, until people would say, why do you do this? I don't really know. I know it helps me in a certain way. I think it really helps me to get rid of my ego, and which I enjoy getting rid of my ego in that way. I think it's much better for me, because then I have no ego problems once I've left the stage. I don't have to sort of keep proving myself over and over again, because I suppose I do it then. That's when I try and concentrate it all. But I really don't know. I mean, I don't think one can really understand that, because when you start off as a performer, you do it, you just want to do it for something to do. It seems very simple at the time. Then the more it goes on, the more involved it gets. You just get drawn into it, and one gets drawn into a pattern, I think, of behavior.
Do you ever feel frightened? Do you ever suddenly become transfixed with the thought that you are isolated on that stage, and so much emotionally is being, at that moment, required of you?
No. I don't feel isolated, because I'm not, because I have other people with me, because I'm part of a group of people. I'm not just on my own, and we all experience more or less the same things, and it's very good, and it's always funny, and we always have a laugh on stage, and we always enjoy ourselves. And I don't feel alone on the stage, and I also don't feel alone because I feel for a sympathy for the audience, in the sort of sympathy in the true sense of the word.
Why, Professor Cohen, does it seem to be usually girls who respond most violently and outward-goingly at these pop concerts?
Well, this is largely an appeal to the feminine heart, the heart of a young girl who worships love and the goddess of love and the heroes of love. And this plays the dominant part in her life, so that the vast majority of the fans are girls who come there to worship at the shrine of the goddess or the young god hero, as they did in the ancient past. There's really no break with the ancient tradition. It's just a question of a form. You have the same sacred, if I may just finish, the same sacred ceremonies, if you like, rituals. You might say the gods are dead, and in the sense that the remoteness of the object of worship is no longer there, and therefore this gap that I spoke about at the beginning is bridged by more participation on the part of those, the outsiders, the exoterics, as contrasted with the esoterics. There's more participation. Everybody wants to be somebody and participate in this mystique. I've seen this with the most marvelous dramatic intensity with the Beatles playing to 2,000 or 3,000 young girls in Manchester. Apart from another journalist, I was the only male in the audience. And I've never experienced anything like it myself. If I were confronted with 10,000 Loch Ness monsters, I wouldn't be so impressed by this whistling and wailing and possession of the soul of these young girls. They were completely, it wasn't hysteria, there was no panic, no chaos, no disorder. It was like the noise on the, I imagine, on the Russian steppes, the whistling of the wind on the wide open spaces. And these girls, they wept, they were taken, possessed by the spirit, and I may add that all their little panties were soaking wet at the end. I mean, a complete physical and mental absorption. And these were unawakened girls. That's why they could let themselves go. If they were sexually mature, they couldn't, I don't think.
He was going to say something.
I think that's very true, and I think what's more interesting is that in this country, this concert you're talking about, say Manchester or something like that, the audience is indeed all girls, and they do behave in this way. But in the rest of the world, this isn't true. There's a completely different audience. They're not, certainly not all girls. In lots of places, they're nearly all boys. And this leads to a completely different kind of, it's the same kind of phenomenon, but it's very different because you get this big sexual thing that goes. Mm. With the boys, it erupts, you know.
Aggressiveness.
Much more aggressively. And they seem, I think, boys being more aware of perhaps their role in, their future role in society, will use this 10,000 of them or 20,000 of them, seen 20,000 boys, old boys, and seen no girls at all, and they use it as to enjoy themselves and also to have a great fight with the police, which of course they were outnumbered. If there's 20,000, if there's 2,000 police, they outnumber them, and they use this to just have a fight with the police. At one of our concerts in Berlin, this happened. They just beat the police up as a show of sort of strength, and a show of dissatisfaction with something. A Beatles concert in Germany, they stole the tear gas, police tear gas, and threw it at the police.
Yeah.
I mean, this is completely different to this concert that you're talking about, with the wailing and the girls' sort of sexual thing.
Well, we're going on now to see something else. If the line between what goes on the stage and what goes on in the auditorium seems to be pretty indistinct, as has emerged at pop concerts, it's vanished altogether by the time you get to the be-in. There's only been one of these things so far in England. It happened the other day at Alexandra Palace. It went on for about 36 hours. It was variously described as a technicolour dream and a 10,000-strong human being. What happened was that everyone went along and did whatever they felt like doing. At the be-in, the audience has become its own performer. It has no delegates for its fantasies. It acts them out in person.